The purpose of what I'm going to say is to bring you up to date with where we are and to remind you about a few background matters which seem still to be the subject of fake news here and there. In other words, there seems to be a collective amnesia about what happened in the past in relation to certain matters, including the planning appeal, but also other similar issues. I mean, I've been meeting recently with the new members of the Transport Select Committee, and preparing for the meeting, I began by rereading the original report of February 2015, which many of you will remember. Many of you were spectators. Just read quickly paragraph 12. We recommend that Anglo places the joint venture agreement between herself, Chris Musgrave and Trevor Carpenter to redevelop Manston in the public domain to make it clear who would benefit from the proposed development of Manston and to repudiate allegations of asset stripping. We would be happy to publish this document on our website. That's 3 years ago. Nothing, of course, has been published, and we remain as much in the dark as we ever were. The other thing to say in relation to the consultation process is that we've now had three consultations. We started in June of 2016 with a non-statutory consultation, which invited responses, and there were events at five separate venues. We followed that up in June of last year with a statutory consultation, at which we had events at 11 separate venues. And finally, just last month, two more events and another consultation period. So that's, I think if my maths is right, that's a total of 18 events. I would also say that all the directors of, or all my colleagues on River Road Strategic Partners, namely myself, George Yerrell and Niall Lawler, appeared at those events to meet the public and answer questions directly. And perhaps even more important, at the Ramsgate event in June of last year, Nick Rothwell, who represents our investors, about whom there's been so much speculation, was there all day in person to answer questions from members of the public. I just make that point that, yes, some of the conversations can be a little strained at times when you engage with members of the public, and members of the public do become angry and annoyed and so on, but it's always been our policy to put ourselves out there and to attempt to deal with everything that's put in front of us. The other thing to remind you about is the planning appeal. I know most of you know this, but it's worth putting this back in context. In 2015, an application was made for non-aviation consent on four buildings at Manston. The planning committee unanimously refused it, rejected it. The appellants, Lothian Shelf as they were then, appealed. The council then decided to commission the famous AVIA report, and upon receipt of the AVIA report, the council withdrew its objection to the appeal. By the time that occurred, we had applied successfully to be heard as interested parties to the appeal. The appeal finally took place in March 2017. Sadly, because of the pressures and cutbacks we all understand, there was very little media coverage of what transpired. But eventually, in July 2017, the inspector published his report, which had been delayed because of the general election, and he found that the policy EC4 says it's an airport remains in force. He was not persuaded by any of the arguments to the contrary, and most significantly, as many of you will remember, the AVIA report was not even attempted to be put in front of the inspector at the appeal. And our evidence, and we had two experts giving evidence for us, was not even challenged. So our advice as far as the current planning framework is concerned is that with the rejection of the draft local plan on the 18th of January, there remain in place certain saved policies, as they're called. One of those saved policies is policy EC4, and so we go into the DCO process in the context of Save Policy DC4, which is to the effect that it is a bloody airport. Now, moving on to where we are with the consultation and the actual DCO application, because some of you may be wondering what's been going on, what we've been doing, and we've been wondering, to some extent, where all the money's gone, because we've spent so much money on this. We had a meeting with our investors on Friday, and I can tell you I've actually got the numbers in front of me here. As of yesterday, the amount that we have spent on the process of bringing Manston back into operation and gaining control of Manston through a DCO and the associated CPO, the actual amount spent so far to yesterday is £7,258,000. That's what we've spent. Now, not bad for a company that's got no money.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I say this... I say this in all humility. We have... Sir Roger and Craig have met our investors and their representatives. We have investors who understand the importance of this, who have not had their hands out for public money. It's all private money that's gone into this. And as you know, at this stage, it's all speculative. It's all at risk. So it is a huge amount of money. By the time we get to the end of the DCO process, in a year's time, that number will probably have grown to £10 million. That's where we are.
We have to knock it off the 300.
No, we can't. I'm afraid. As far as the documentation is concerned, this is another issue. I know many of you will have looked at the website, and I'm looking for David Stevens, who undoubtedly will be able to appear on Mastermind with DCO as his specialist subject. He knows it better than I do. The amount of material out there is just overwhelming. And I would say to you this, the system is one that requires you to produce almost endless material, particularly on the environmental side. I think it's right that's the case. And we knew before we started that we wouldn't get a DCO unless we complied with the regulations. But the result is, and I've got some more numbers for you here, as we complete the process, the application, which actually has to be printed and bound in an old-fashioned volume, will have 4,020 A4 pages, 100 A3 pages, and 100 A1 pages. That's how much material has gone into it. And if I can say to you, I'm quoting from my running order here, this is just the environmental consultancies. The environmental consultancy is responsible for putting all that together and complying with the regulations. Their combined fees so far run to
£1,122,007.
All I would say to you is this. When you produce as much material as that, there's always an opportunity for someone out there to accuse you of hiding something in the small print, or something is tucked away on page 3011. All I can say to that is, the material is all there, it's there for everyone to read. We are not allowed to make shortcut summaries of it, because of course the rules are, you know, if you do that, you may be tempted, or even by accident, misrepresent something that's in the detail of the report. So we can't. The material is all there, it's spread out into chapters. Those people who are interested in certain parts of it can read what they want to read. And the point of the consultation is for people to respond to that. So, as far as our programme is concerned now, I can tell you this. The consultation closes on the 16th of February. 16th, yes. We've been getting more responses in, and and our duty is to respond to them. Some of them from statutory consultees as well. So we have people like Historic England who now agreed or are agreeing a statement of common ground with us, which is encouraging. We appear to have reached a statement of common ground with the Environment Agency, which is also a huge breakthrough for us. So all of that's good. We have to then spend, well, the rules say you have to give due weight to all the responses and write them up in the document. So that will probably add another few pages to the 4,020. We then have 3 days in what we're calling a locked data room, the 5th, 6th and 7th of March, where the entire team will be engaged on going through the document line by line, page by page, to make sure that there are no inaccuracies or errors or nothing of the overlook. Because that's what the process requires. And when you produce that amount of material by so many different consultants, there's always an outside risk that something needs to be corrected or something's been missed. Once that process is over, the application will be ready to be submitted. And that's basically where we are. It really has been a huge operation. It has probably been more complicated than some of us expected. We'd assumed, and I think some of our consultants had assumed, that because this had been an airport since just under 4 years ago, because most things were known about it, that compared with some of the other DCOs that have been done, it would be relatively straightforward. That has not proved to be the case, not because of opposition or objections, frankly, but simply because it's an airport. There are airspace issues. There are issues relating to it that didn't apply to the tidal bay promotion in Swansea or the Thames tunnel or even Hinckley. So we found ourselves in areas that we hadn't expected to be in. We've had to deal with those. There then was, of course, as you know, a change in the regulations last year, and we were advised that we should comply with the up-to-date ones, which involved even more work. So the work is just about finished now. And the one last thing that I wanted to say something about and leave with you as a thought is the issue of night flights and night noise, because it won't go away, and I'd be surprised if it did go away. The first thing to say is there will undoubtedly be a hearing, maybe 2 days, maybe 3 days of hearings, conducted by the inspector on this issue. You've heard me say this before, we don't get to decide this. This will be decided ultimately by the Secretary of State. What is our position? And again, just to state the position in principle and then try and explain how this relates to what we'll be putting forward in the document. We have designed an airport which we believe will have no daytime constraints. That's why there are so many parking stands there. And it is interesting, by a process almost of reverse logic, if you read the AVIA report and the report of York Aviation that was commissioned by Stonewall Park, there's a suggestion there that you can achieve high levels of cargo on quite small amounts of infrastructure, which fails to understand how cargo works, that many cargo planes will sit on the ground for hours on end, occupying valuable space and preventing other aircraft using that space. And secondly, that if you have a kind of a constrained operation like the one that they're describing, it forces you to have night flights because you can't get anything in during the day. That then takes you on to the next point, which is who out there wants night flights? Well, our proposal, as you know, is largely based on bringing big freighters into Manston, and there is no demand out there for big freighter traffic to come in at night. So what is the issue about night flying? Well, one of the problems that besets the air freight world is lack of reliability, problems at other airports. Many of the inbound flights that we'll be receiving will be coming from airports in parts of the world where there are power outages, where there are problems on the ground. And if you don't have the flexibility to receive an incoming aircraft, say, that's full of perishables, where you say, sorry, it's after 2300, you can't come in, hard luck, you just have to dump the load somewhere, you can't do business like that. And that's generally accepted in the industry. You need that sort of flexibility. Now, to me, what's most interesting, having been involved in this all these years, is that when we, in those days, sat down with the then Senate Council in the year 2000-2001 to discuss the old Section 106 agreement, we explained these issues. We sat with elected members and officers and explained the issues and the need for flexibility. And because there was an understanding of the need for flexibility, the Section 106 in its original form emerged, which basically said no night flights, certainly no scheduled night flights, but the flexibility to take in unscheduled night flights as necessary in those kinds of circumstances. And that's basically what this is about. There's a further issue which has to do with the noise, the different noise, the different level of noise from an inbound aircraft and an outbound aircraft. And this is also very important. So, the noisiest aircraft that we're ever likely to take into Manston is a 747-400. A 747-400, and just to say something about QC codes, I don't claim to be an expert. We have material in our presentation, in our consultation documents about QC counts and quota count. But basically, and this is a DFT-approved policy, there is a measure called effective perceived noise in decibels, EPNDB. And that then is related to a quota count which is attached to different kinds of aircraft. So to give you a feel for this, the noisiest aircraft that would have come to Manston in the old days would have been MK Cargo 747-200s, which don't fly anymore. On departure, they had a QC count of 16.16. That's about as high as it goes. In fact, there isn't anything higher than that. That was an effective perceived noise in decibels level of over 101. The latest, by comparison, 747-800s on departure don't have a QC count of 16, they have a QC count of 2. That's how much quieter they are. And that makes a huge difference. A huge difference. So you're dealing with perception, memory, and sometimes exaggerated memory of noise that came from inbound aircraft, plus the fact that in the old days it was not possible to actually control the height at which these aircraft were coming in. It is now possible to do that. So if an aircraft is supposed to be at 680 feet over central landscape, but chooses to come in at 300 feet, in the old days there's nothing you could do about that. Today there is. You can find them, you can ban them from the airport, or you can ban the pilot from the airport if it happens too often. So what we tried to do, we're obliged by the rules to model worst case scenario. But the reason we've spent so much money on environmentalists is we have to model the environmental impact of absolutely everything. I mean, literally everything. So at its most extreme, we're talking about recycling aircraft. We've got to model the environmental impact of the lorries that will take away the recycled remains of those aircraft to wherever they're going to end up in recycled form. Let's say an aluminium recycling plant in the Midlands. You've got to model all of that. Everything has been modeled. So we have to model the impact of some night flights. We can't say we want flexibility and then say, well, we're not going to tell you what the impact of that is, because that's not allowed. And that's how all this has come about. So we've tried as best we can to model that. and our advisors attempting to relate that to QC count levels. I have to say, in fairness of the consultation events, a number of people said that there was some illogicality in what we were doing, and that some of it, on one reading, it sounded as though we were going for more permission for more flights than we apparently intended. We've looked at that and said, yes, maybe we've given that wrong impression. So we're going away and looking at that again. And that's one of the things that's happening actually this coming week. We've got a team of people coming together to consider that. But just to repeat the comment, no secret plan to have huge numbers of night flights, no mythical airline out there waiting to sign up for night flights. And just to reassure you still further, we've been tracking what's going on in the market, in particular of what Amazon are up to, because everyone's tracking what they're doing. And it is interesting, in that they're located in an airfield in, well, they call it Cincinnati, it's actually in North Kentucky. And they've a fleet of, it's growing all the time, of around 20 aircraft at the moment. And they have elected to replicate what Ryanair do with passenger flights. In other words, all the aircraft are based at Cincinnati overnight. They're loaded overnight, they do all that stuff overnight. They don't fly at night. They depart Cincinnati for all parts of the US in the morning. They fly out, they disperse their loads, and they return to home base in the evening. And there are no night routes. And that seems to be an evolving business model that works for them. We say that makes a lot of sense, it fits in with what we're saying. And of course, if we have the amount of infrastructure on our airport that we're planning, we'll be able to accommodate an operation like that. Whereas if we only had six stands, we'd have to say to them, we can't take all your flights, some of them will have to come in at night. That's the whole point of this. So that's a sort of rather convoluted way of explaining where we are on that. Just one last point. There will be, I suppose for us and for all of us, a number of days of tension after the application is submitted, because the planning inspectorate has 28 days, only 28 days, in which to accept it for examination. So if the application is submitted, say, on the 11th of March or whatever date it may be, there's a 28-day period in which nothing happens and we all wait. And we'll all have to wait together, I'm afraid. That's just the way the system is. Once it's been accepted, and I say that because we believe that we comply with everything we can possibly comply with, once it's been accepted for examination, there will be a process by which the planning inspectorate will decide how many inspectors to appoint. It could be one, it could be two, it could be three. The inspector or inspectors will then hold a preliminary meeting or meetings at which they will decide what are the issues that are to be the subject of a public examination. I've no doubt that night flights will be one of them. I've no doubt that Stone the Parks people will be saying this is never going to work as an airport and we want a hearing to persuade you that this is hopeless and isn't viable. And then there will be other issues to do with environmental matters generally. How many hearings there will be, I don't know. They are informal hearings. The way it works these days is the inspector will chair, sit at a long table and invite people to speak, and will ask them questions. He'll give the opportunity to people who don't agree with them to ask them questions as well. But it will all be informal. And that process can last a maximum of 6 months. At the end of the 6 months, the inspector or inspectors write the report. They have a maximum of 3 months in which to do that. And then there's a further 3 months at the end of which the Secretary of State, in this case the Transport, will approved, we expect. So that's what lies ahead of us. So I think, frankly, considering that we are people who apparently are secretive and mysterious and broke. We haven't done too badly. And honestly, I know I get, we get wonderful expressions of support from you guys. It does matter a lot to us. Really, it does. And just finally, to dispel some of the impressions out there, we, even with the latest consultation events, and remember we were at two venues where there is some hostility to the airfield, it looks as though the pro-anti balance is 60 to 65 to 35 to 40, something like that. And remember, this is not a popularity contest. If it was a popularity contest, then we never got an approval for Hinckley. It is a question of consulting and showing that everyone in the local community has an opportunity to have their say and to understand what's being said and done. And I think, and I will close on this, the final comment really is about the local authority here. The sadness for us is that we've had to listen to stuff that, is just so wrong and so ill-informed from certain quarters. And all we wanted to do was to engage with them, and I mean, in a public forum, we don't want to be to the restaurant or anything like that. It's to engage with them in a public forum and have them ask their questions and satisfy themselves as to what we're doing. Because you have hard-pressed council officers struggling to stay on top of a huge project, God knows, 4,000 pages. If we were able to work in harmony with them, their lives and our lives would be so much easier. And I'm hoping that circumstances will be such that as this goes through, that whole thing will change. So that's where we are. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.